focused on the target because the vestibular ocular reflex moves opposite to the direction of the head movement and doesn't move your eyes. However, if there's a problem, then the vestibular ocular reflex is weak. The eye will move in the direction of the head, but there will be a quick catch-up saccade which will bring the eye back to the target. That's called the compensatory saccade, which is produced by the generated by the brain. So this is the way you do it. So that's the fixed target there. Now, this was very early days. I'm not doing it right, by the way. I apologize. I've touched the band. You should never touch the band. You should never, ever touch the band. But these were early days, as I said. We were still learning. Unfortunately, I don't have a good another video. So this is when you do it with the video head impulse, when you are measuring it. And this is the compensatory saccade you see. See, I'm thrusting or moving the head on. It's a thrust. Wait for it. There we go. Nothing there. Left, clear catch-up saccade. Clear catch-up saccade. And this is when you do it clinically. So if you don't have the equipment to do this, then do not despair. You can do it clinically, but in clinical, you can't see a covert saccade, which is generated when during the head movement. What you see clinically is an overt saccade, which occurs after the head movement. So I'll show you this clinical one. This is a child as well, once again taken from my mentor, Prof. Wiener. So watch carefully the saccade. There we go. Beautiful saccade on the right and the left. So bilateral vestibular hypofunction in bilateral sensory or hearing loss. In fact, this was one of the videos which I borrowed from Silvet, and this set me to a career in vestibular medicine because I loved it. So this is the V-hit trace that you see. On the left side, it's completely normal, beautiful. So when the eye moves with the head on the opposite side, that's called, the ratio is called a VOR gain. So you can clearly eyeball here, and of course you can read the figures. So clearly see the eyeball here, the eyes are moving with the head, the blue is the head, the green is the eye. However, on the right side, it is not moving. So the orange is the head, the green is the eye. They're not moving together, there's a lag, and that lag is fulfilled or compensated by these spikes, which we call catch-up saccade. So this is a right-sided three semicircular canal weakness. So previously, we could only check one semicircular canal, which is the lateral one, but now we are in a position to check all six canals, three on each side. And this is the revolution that I'm speaking about. This has changed pretty much everything. And we'll also talk about this when I go to the compensation section, that it changes over a period of time. It changes with compensation. And that is absolutely crucial for us to understand. So we will go through that in a bit. So the functional head impulse test is another beautiful test which is developed by Stefan Rahmat in Padova. I'm sure it's Padova. I think it's Padova. Which is an extension of the video head impulse test. Now, you know, speech audiometry is the functional part of Pearson audiometry where it becomes more behavioral. This is a behavioral test which utilizes an objective test. So what you are doing here is basically, it's like it acts on the principle of retinal slip, which is basically you are measuring how much your eye can catch up with a movement. So there are different optotypes present, and the subject is asked to identify the optotypes correctly when you are moving the head. And this generates some wonderful curves, what I call the Manhattan. And look, they kind of measure the vestibular lateral semicircular response across a range of velocities. So once again, you get quite frequency-specific, velocity-specific information. And it's got a very good relation with the video impulses. Now, no one has tried this in the pediatric population, as far as I know, and we are going to start it shortly because we have just got the machine. So this will be very interesting as to what we see. But remember, this is very much subjective. So you need the patient's cooperation in full. So I don't think it will be possible in younger kids. It would be only possible in kids who do a Pearson audiometry. So it's probably 4+. We haven't started as yet. And this is absolutely very, very new. This is a suppression head impulse test, which was once again discovered by the MacDougall team in Sydney with Ian Courthois. And my friend and colleague, Leonardo Manzari, was part of that team. When they first introduced the test, I was in two minds. I didn't much believe the test because I thought VOR suppression, which means when there's a moving target, your eyes are tracking the target, you're overriding your VOR. That's a voluntary effort for the simple reason you might not want to track that object. So if it's a voluntary effort, then the VOR suppression is very much central. So why should it be a peripheral test? It should be more central. So what are they talking about? But now, after going through 8 years of the suppression and impulse test and doing it in pediatrics, doing it in children, and Leonardo and I, we have recently published, only 2 days back, it has come out in Frontiers, it's provisionally accepted in Frontiers, about the first pathological SHIMP cohort in the pediatric population. I am a complete convert, and I think that the SHIMP not only adds to your VHIT results, but also on its own is an absolutely fantastic, almost to the point of a mind-boggling test, because it gives you, I think, very important information about the status of not only of your vestibular system, but also crucially how much it has compensated. And remember, in a child, it's absolutely crucial because you need to know which stage of compensation a child is in. Just by noting symptoms is not enough. You'll have to make a judgment how much compensation, because on that will depend how much will you treat the child, rehabilitation or otherwise. How much do you have to engage the school? If a child has not compensated completely, then he'll go and talk to the school, tell them that, look, these are the different playground activities which this child will not do. And if he falls, please do not tell him off. So can you see the level of engagement that you need to do with different people around the child? It's not just the ear anymore. It's not just the vestibular system anymore. It's a child that you are talking about. And that philosophy, that attitude, that kind of ethos needs to be inculcated if you want to do a pediatric vestibular medicine. So the principle is slightly different from the HIT, from the HIMP protocol. Sorry, HIT is now called HIMP, Head Impulse Protocol. So as you see, the last time the target was fixed. Here, the target moves. You can hardly see. So that's the red light which moves. And the subject this time, my resident, who very much can double up as a teenager, who is looking at the target as the target is moving. And then what you see is, because you're overriding your VOR, you get what we call an anti-compensatory circuit. So the eye moves towards the direction of the head movement. So it's obviously downward, and all these spikes, and this is the gain again. And VOR, and it has been said, and we have shown that the SHIMP VOR gain is probably a better indicator than the HIMP VOR gain. Why? Because in the HIMP VOR gain, covert saccades influence the gain. Whereas in SHIMP, it's called a covert saccade killer. You get hardly any covert saccades. So the VOR gain that you get, the average VOR gain, that is VOR gain across a number of trials, divided by the number of trials, is a more sensitive indicator. At least that's what the literature says. And SHIMP changes with compensation as well. That's so important, because essentially what the original discovery said was that it is an index of compensation. What we have found from our study, and it will be available online, all formalities have been done, hopefully the next few days, please have a read. I'll send another literature. What we have found is a very interesting observation in some of our kids. When you do a VHIT, this is a real patient, by the way, completely normal. However, when you do a SHIM, you see, I'll show you something. You see this asymmetry, 39% on the, I think this is the left. The gain is 0.59, on the right it's 0.96. So there is an asymmetry of 39% between the two sides. And the velocity, the average velocity of this left side of the saccades is less than that. What does that mean? That means that there could have been previous left-sided vestibular damage or assault, and you will try to find out the cause, of course. So how does compensation behave? The first thing of compensation, cerebral compensation, remember, a child's compensation is like quite different from an adult, because a child's brain is highly plastic, far more plastic and redundant than an adult. So what happens is cerebral plasticity kicks in, the VOR gain is first restored. Next, the saccades are still abnormal. So you might get a situation where the VOR gain is normal, but saccades are abnormal, which is once again, we now prove that it is a legacy of previous vestibular damage. Now, the saccades slowly start to disappear with more compensation because the brain adjusts to the brainstem, which is the saccade generator. However, the VOR suppression takes a long time to go away. VOR suppression abnormalities, it lingers on. And it lingers on as asymmetry and a reduction of peak saccadic velocity of anticompensatory movements. This is what we have actually found in our children. And we have reported this for the first time. Now, obviously, this is still very early days, but this is what we have found in a significant number of kids. So asymmetry and peak saccadic velocity are important indicators of vestibular compensation. Next, I'm going to show you two tests which are not frequency specific, but they are etiology specific, which means they tell you about the etiology. This is a child who was unable to play cricket because every time he wants to hit the bat, he was very dizzy and lightheaded. And this is what I found. I asked him to hyperventilate. Now remember, hyperventilation is not a very easy test. It's a complex and sometimes it can be a dangerous test, especially in epileptic kids. So do not do it on everybody. Only when you have got a good clinical justification, do it. So ask the child to hyperventilate 20 times or 30 times, slightly older child, and then watch the eyes. Now you can see this is a post-hyperventilation in nystagmus, which changes its direction with increase in something. What is it? This is a diagnostic test of a cerebellopontine angle lesion, which can be a tumor, which can be an arteriovenous malformation, which can be a cross-arterial Shavda type compression of the vestibular cochlear nerve by the anterior inferior cerebellar artery, or in 20% cases by the posterior inferior cerebellar artery, anatomical variation. Now, this kid had a cerebellopontine angle lipoma because acoustic in a middle teenager, 14, 15, is not terribly common unless it's part of a neurofibromatosis spectrum. This kid had a lipoma, which I'll show you. I've got an MR scan later. So that's one test. The second test I'm going to show you is disequilibrium autophony. Unable to sing in the school choir because hated their own voice. And this is what I found. This is an Henneberg's test where you press the tragus, or you can use a Valsalva, or you can use a Siegel's. So tragal pressure or Valsalva followed by a classical torsional nystagmus. I'm still pressing the tragus here. And you'll see the nystagmus appear. There we go. You can see the torsion. This was a superior semicircular canal dehiscence bilateral in a young child, teenager. So these, they give you the etiology right, right? So this is fantastic. They just tell you what the problem is. So Henneberg sign is a feature of third window disorders. Caloric response, still useful in adults, of course, but in kids, I don't do it because I don't want to distress them unnecessarily, but they are highly sensitive and specific objective test. I would use it occasionally in kids when I'm instructed by the court for legal purposes. So you can show, so what you saw so far, we looked into the semicircular canal system, right? So we did see the different frequency ranges. For the vertical canals only, we could see the high frequency ones, but for the lateral, we had a whole range, 0 to 7, low, mid, 0, low, mid, high. What about the otoliths? Well, you'll be surprised to know, this is once again a very recent thing, that you can measure otolith frequency functions as well. So the physiological high frequency counterpart of the head impulse test is what we call a head heave. So in the head impulse, you move the in a rolling plane, whereas on the head heave, you move it translationally. And this is what happens. Watch for the saccade, once again, fixating on a target. So watch for the saccade, it's going to come. There we go, on the right, and again, nothing, and on the right. Beautiful saccade. And this has got a good correlation with OVEMS in children, at least, in adults, because in my private practice, I see adults and they've got a good correlation with OVEM, but that's, I haven't published this yet. And we have just started OVEMS in kids in Alder Hey to gathering our own norms. So it will be very interesting to see the correlation with head heave with the OVEM. It may be found normally because, you know, you might make a prejudgment. Be very careful, don't get caught out, because if you have got a positive headache, it must match with the symptoms. Now, here, let me just briefly tell you, and this is something which is very much undercurrent and almost invariably ignored. Can I tell you today that otolith symptoms are different from semicircular canal symptoms? That is, otolith weakness symptoms are different from semicircular canal weakness symptoms. Semicircular canal weakness symptoms is classically vertigo or spinning, but it can be anything, of course. There is difficult ambulation in the dark, which means when you switch the lights off, the child will lose his balance because vision can't compensate. Whereas for otoliths, the classical complaint is what we call a non-vertiginous dizziness. Remember this word, non-vertiginous dizziness. What are they? Rocking, swaying, tilting. I look down and the ground is rushing towards me. The positional, you will say that positional dizziness. For example, when I'm moving my head like that, when I'm doing that, this is BPPV. Now, BPPV is extremely rare in kids, but they still have this dizziness. So positional dizziness, which is not BPPV, is otolith dysfunction. And nowadays, there is a different entity called isolated otolith dysfunction, which has been discovered by a good colleague from South Korea, Matthew Suk, and by the great giant Toshira Murafishi from Japan. They have proposed this isolated otolith dysfunction. Now we can diagnose this with all these tests and, of course, the VEMPs. So you can imagine why I keep on saying that we are living in a golden era. We can accurately pinpoint where in the vestibular system the problem is. And isn't that an absolutely wonderful thing? So headache is the high frequency counterpart of VHIT assessing high frequency utricular function. Now, 0 degree is nystagmus in case of lateral canal. For the utricle, it's a subjective visual vertical. So that's a completely 90 degree subjective visual vertical. If you see a tilt like that, you can measure this tilt. You can have very high-tech stuff. You can use your iPhone, you can use a bucket test. What I do is simple protractor, borrowed from a geometry box. If it's 5 to 10 degrees, then that's abnormal. It can come only from a few conditions. One is a spasmodic torticollis of your neck, neurological condition. One is a squint, because the retinal axis needs to be aligned in squints. The head makes a compensatory head turn. But the commonest by far is a vestibular problem. Remember, and I have found a high correlation between a subjective visual tilt, vertical tilt, and motion sickness. Motion sickness is now otolith central mismatch, it has been proved. So otolith weakness can generate motion sickness. You might have been born with it, any child might have born with it. And a very recent addition, which nowadays we can measure, but previously I just used to record the eye movements, is an ocular counter roll. That's once again utricular response. So what happens is you move the head all the way and ask the child, touch on the shoulder, and you see the eyes are rolling. There are two types of roll. One is a static roll, which is displacement from point A to point B. How far is the eye going? Is it going from the central position all the way to the peripheral? And one is dynamic. It's actually rolling from point A to B. Static, remember, is utricular. Dynamic, remember, is secular. I'll show you. Look. Just watch the eyes move beautifully. So there we go, one side, other side. So it moves like that. And nowadays you can measure it. This is how it looks like when you are physically measuring it, and you get numbers and quantify an ocular counter roll. I think some of the latest equipment have actually brought this into the market, where you can measure an ocular counter roll, a very useful test, but on its own indicates nothing. You'll have to match it with symptoms, you'll have to match it with subjective visual vertical, the headache, and all those tests. Skew deviation, many equipments have got it, and we do it routinely in our kids. Remember, 1/3 of skew deviation is because of an otolith problem. It can be central because it's a part of hints. But what I have found in kids, that, and of course in adults, that it is important to measure otolith function in 1/3 of cases, one type of skew deviation. VEMP, not much to say. Once again, revolution. This is a beautiful VEMP. Colic response, vestibular colic response. Now, when you are looking into VEMP, always, always, always consider the rectified amplitude, because this amplitude which you see here is sternocleidomastoid inherent activity plus the WEMF response. The WEMF response is buried in here. So the machine, your computer, will actually, software will actually measure the rectified amplitude and always consider this. And never consider absolute amplitudes. Always, always, always do the calculation for asymmetry. That's the asymmetry which you do the calculation. And do the asymmetry calculation from rectified amplitudes. Because this machine, at least this machine which I used, does not, it does not use rectified amplitudes to measure asymmetry, it uses absolute amplitudes. And the inference is, as you know, increased amplitude is a classical feature of third windows, and decreased threshold is now considered to be more important than increased amplitude. So if you get a decreased threshold, now therein lies a problem, because in kids, it's very difficult to do thresholds in many instances, because children had to put in a lot of effort to do the WEMF test, CWEMF test. Because what I do here, the technique is, I put my hand on the cheek of a child, and then ask the child to press against my hand to make my sternocleidomastoid. But this is a lot of muscle activity, and sometimes when you have to do thresholds, you'll have to do more than 3, 4, 5 runs. It's very difficult for the child to sustain the mid. So not in all cases would you be able to do thresholds, but you should try. At least you should try. Ocular is the inferior oblique response. We have just started doing it in kids in our center, and hardly any tests, hardly any series have been published regarding pediatric OVEMs, but we have started. We have done about 15 now, and we are eagerly awaiting the first 30, which we aim to publish. Once again, this measures, of course, utricular response. CVEMP measures saccular response, but quite useful for third window conditions and for otolith weakness. Quite a few vestibulospinal tests, for example, the Romberg, the Sharp and Romberg, Unterberger, always use a foam cushion. Now that is something which you can do in your clinic. If you don't have a foam cushion, then obviously you can use a simple pillow or a cushion. Because the idea is, after you ask the child to close the eyes, you are eliminating vision and you are eliminating the proprioception as well by removing the friction. So it's some kind of a static posturography. I do not do dynamic posturography in all my kids, but only selected who have got a significant gait problem. So I would do dynamic posturography to assess progression following treatment, not as a diagnostic test. Because dynamic posturography is extremely expensive kit. We have got it in our gait laboratory, but it's an expensive kit. And also, you know, those tests where you actually put the child in a harness in different situations, 6 different positions, might be quite scary. So I would only do it in selected cases. Now, Meniere's disease in kids is very rare. If it is there, then it is usually secondary, and in many cases due to an autoimmune condition. Only the other day, I picked up a Meniere's disease in a child, Meniere's syndrome in a child. Sorry, Meniere's disease is idiopathic by definition. Meniere's syndrome is the right term, what I would call high drops. So only the other day I picked up high drops in a child with an elevated anti-oligodendrocyte antibody. So if you see or if you assess a kid with and come up with a diagnosis of Meniere's syndrome, always look for the immune profile and inflammatory markers, ESR, CRP, the different antibodies, immunoglobulin profile. You never know what you will unearth. And this is the absolutely latest modern criteria suggested for obtaining a biomarker, an objective biomarker for Meniere's syndrome. The calorics do not match with the VHIT. The calorics might be abnormal, VHIT normal, and the other way around. You might get an Henneberth sign, because in the early stages a Meniere's behaves like a third window. You might get a normal VOR gain, but with saccades. And the very latest one is a WEMP low threshold and an increased frequency tuning ratio. So different stimuli, different intensity WEMP, and you measure the WEMP response. And that comes up with a tuning curve, which might be abnormal. And tone burst EKG is also showing promise, but it's an invasive procedure. So these are the interesting proposals for biomarker in my lab. If there's a Meniere's, I still don't do a caloric, but I'll definitely do a VHIT, I'll do a WEMP, I'll do a Henneberth, I'll do a WEMP, and I don't do a tone burst EKG. Do not forget a neurological examination. Absolutely crucial. Do not forget a musculoskeletal examination. How many of you in a routine ENT clinic seeing a child or even an adult with a balanced disorder, do you actually measure the leg from the anterosuperior iliac spine to the lateral malleolus? Can you please tell me, do you do that? I do it on all my kids, because I know that falls in a child, the commonest cause is lower limb biomechanical abnormalities. Simple things, flat feet, genu valgum, pes planus, that is a flat feet, different types of coxa, leg length discrepancy, hyperelastic joints, not vestibular. You remember are not there to pick up a vestibular weakness and focus all your energy. You are there to pick up why this kid doesn't have good balance. And balance is not necessarily and exclusively limited to the vestibular system. No, it can come from so many different. It can come from the heart. It can come from a simple anemia. It can come from fatigue. It can come from a liver disorder. It can come from a rheumatological disorder. So that's why, once again, I keep on saying you need this knowledge and insight of other pediatric disciplines if you have to make a correct diagnosis. The right diagnosis and the correct diagnosis. Because remember, in vestibular medicine, diagnosis is king. Without diagnosis, you are nowhere. I mean, you can still do empirical symptomatic relief. A kid is dizzy, give him some anti-dizzy pills, but that's not good enough because you're not treating the root cause, and that is absolutely crucial. So diagnosis is so, so, so important. Of course, you should always do a cardiovascular examination. You know, only the other day, I had a child who presented with dizziness. So that child felt very fuzzy-headed. No one could figure out. Neurologically, it said, well, there's nothing neurological sent to me. And the vestibular system was completely normal. You know what I did? I measured the blood pressure and everything. All I did was listen to the heart. And there was a murmur. And murmur heard through the stethoscope, not through the echocardiogram. So I sent this kid to my cardiology colleague, who asked me one question. I thought you were a doctor for the year. And finally, it found out that there was an arrhythmia which generated the murmur, diagnosed from an otology clinic, just because I kept an open mind, just because I've trained. I've seen my pediatric cardiology colleagues work when I was a trainee. If I did not do the training, I wouldn't have even bothered. Why? Never forget to examine the eyes. If you have got an ophthalmoscope, use the ophthalmoscope. It's not easy in a child. Use it, but definitely look for eye movements and definitely look for convergence. Because remember, convergence problems in kids, and a beautiful paper by Jacob Brodsky there, convergence problems in kids, they do mimic a vestibular phenotype. Also, Silvet has been telling me this for a very long time. So always watch, always observe, and always diagnose a convergence problem. And of course, look, one thing which I frequently get asked, you are behaving as if you are one for all, which means that you are a complete doctor. Are you? I say, no, I'm not a complete doctor. No, I'm not an ophthalmologist. I'm not a rheumatologist. I'm not an endocrinologist. I'm not a neurologist. But what I am, I know that if problems occur in these systems, I can pick them up for further management. So look, if I pick up a neurological problem, if I pick up a rheumatological problem, if I pick up an orthopedic problem, I'll pick it up, yes. But I do not know what to do next, so I'll involve my colleagues. That brings me to a crucial point. Treating balance disorder in kids is a multidisciplinary approach. Not just me, many people, because you never know what you can unearth. Full motor assessment, so that's why you need to know the different motor milestones. Hand upon chest, how many of you would, you have learned this in medical school, of course you have, there's no doubt about it. And some of you might still do it, especially the pediatricians. But actually, how much of you actually physically, actually you ask the parents and see the red book or seeing the medical records as to what development milestones are? We often forget this in the grand scale of things, but it's very important because delays in here might point out to a vestibular problem, and this combined with everything else, well, voila, you've got your case. Fine motor assessment, dropping knives, dropping things, building blocks, that's a cognitive vestibular interaction, along with other things, of course. There are a few psychometric questionnaires, so the Vanderbilt Dizziness Handicap Inventory, which is a good one, which I tend to use. Berg Balance Scale has been, the pediatric Berg Balance Scale, my physiotherapy colleagues would use, but I'm not trained, so I know when I do not know things, so I'll send it to them. Berg Balance Scale is very good for lower limb biomechanical problems. So you have found out a kid who's frequently falling unsteady. you have quantified the vestibular system, you have taken a good history, there is no vestibular behavior, you're happy the vestibular system is unscathed and intact, but you have seen there's a leg length discrepancy and completely flat feet. You will send this kid to physiotherapy, who will then do a Berg balance scale and monitor the response after physiotherapy. And of course, the infant motor development scale is also quite nice, which the Flanders group is using when they're doing their motor assessment for BEMS. So that's a very good one. I have never used it, but I plan to use it when I start my 6-month-olds. So this is what we have introduced. It's called a vestibulogram, just like an audiogram. We have gone through all these different tests. Of course, you'll have to do a full audiological assessment, goes without saying, because 1/3 of sensorineural hearing losses are accompanied with a concomitant vestibular problem, genetic or otherwise. Cardiovascular assessment, ophthalmological assessment, musculoskeletal, a complete check of the neurological system. You must be very well trained in identifying eye movements. The central eye movements in my own archive, I have got about 81 different central eye movements, which all tell you a story. They're not vestibular, they are central. And of course, in the middle, you get your beautiful frequency-specific vestibular test battery, golden era of vestibular medicine. That's what we are in. Can you imagine, even 10, 15 years back, this was unthinkable. And it's getting there. It's getting better and better. And I'm privileged, along with other colleagues, for example, Salvo. Salvo is revolutionizing adult vestibular diagnostics in BPPV. Salvo and a few of my other colleagues. So, you know, it's just such a good time to be involved in this field. And after today's lecture, if I have even enthused you even slightly, motivated you even slightly to do this, then you know that is a vindication of my effort. So now what I'm going to tell you is a bit peculiar. You see, whatever tests I showed you, barring a few, for example, the primitive reflex, they can also be done in adults. So how does pediatric vestibular diagnosis differ from adults? The key thing is improvisation, which is not written in any book. It's not. You'll have to devise your own way of testing a child. You'll have to get down to the level of the child to play with him. Sometimes I'm asked by my residents and some colleagues, a severely autistic child who will not sit, who will move, how on earth would you measure the vestibular ocular reflex? You can. We have got a special toy, which is a sensory toy. So it's like a big cylinder with lots of fluid inside, like bubbles, which change colors. And they're very velvety touch. I have distracted autistic kids with that one as a visual target. So they hold that thing, they look at it in mesmerized, they're mesmerized by this all beautiful lights and everything. And then you put the goggles in and you do. Started by Herbert von Karajan in the Berlin Philharmonic. This is the real deal, right? Have a listen. Beautifully, I'm feeling vertiginous, I'm feeling spinning, you know, when I put my head down, I'm getting a tinnitus along with it, with episodic dizziness, and my hearing drops. Beautiful history, the real deal. A child looking at you like that. Mom says, maybe a vague facial expression, sometimes it happens during the day. So you need to get this history out, and that's where you improvise and do your test. So this is the same piece of music played on a guitar by a genius. Same music. Listen to this. You are getting the same information. essence of pediatric vestibular medicine. Right? Improvise. Mind is open. Plenty of things to consider. Child as a whole in front of me. That is my world. That is my universe. And I'm not going to deviate from it. Imaging in pediatrics is pretty much the same, but of course sometimes you'll have to do general anesthesia. So, you know, when you are trying to assess the temporal bonus, especially day senses, fine day senses, you need definite planes. For example, the Stenberg and Boschkel and the slices, reformat slices 0.3, and radiation is pretty much minimized by the cone beam technology. MR scan, once again, to look into the soft tissue, different techniques, and you do different weights, for example, a T2 weight, a T1 weight. That lipoma, I told you, came into the fore by a phenomena called chemical shift on the T1, which is too complex now to explain, but you can actually perform a histological diagnosis by different MR techniques of space occupying lesions, and that's absolutely brilliant. And now, the thing which has erupted over the last few years is the hydrops technique for Meniere's diseases. This is very difficult to do in kids. I've never tried. I did try, but I was refused because of logistic purposes and some ethical considerations. But this is slowly gaining ground in adult medicine. So as you can see, different sections. I'm not going to dwell them on detail. These are the things that you see. And on the coronal cut, on the Stenberg cut actually, see a superior semicircular canal and lateral semicircular canal, and this was taught to me by one of my radiology colleagues. This is what they call a playboy by Bunny sign. So that's the superior canal, that's the lateral canal. If you don't have the roof, then that's a day sense. Different type of dysmorphic aplasia, for example, Michel, there is no cochlea, no vestibular system, absent cochlea, normal cochlea, so different kinds of tests. I'm just going to rattle through them. X-linked gusher, all these are from my collection. So you can make out different bony abnormalities. And remember, all these are also accompanied with hearing loss and a vestibular problem. Trauma, 3D reconstruction, you should see the fracture line. Otherwise, you might not be able to see the fracture line. Very tiny fracture line here. Very tiny green arrow fracture line there. Different types of dehiscence, near semicircular canal dehiscence, thinning of the roof between 0.1 to 0.3, not millimeters, not completely absent. Clear breach here, posterior semicircular canal dehiscence, and thinning of the posterior semicircular canal. So all these things, they can be figured out with this enlarged vestibular aqueduct direct IEM. You can pick up facial canal dehiscence, carotid canal dehiscence, so on and so forth. All these things are beautifully delineated by a CT scan, and we have got fantastic radiology colleagues here who do it for us. An MRI, of course, looks into the soft tissue, and this is one of the things which I'd like to show you. This is in this view, you can very clearly see the facial nerve, the cochlear nerve, superior vestibular nerve, and the inferior vestibular nerve. Only that day, I think about a couple of weeks back or a week back, we diagnosed a case with an inferior vestibular nerve hypoplasia. And can you imagine what the testing showed? This kid was decompensating because he also had a hormonal problem. So do you remember, just kind of, I'll tell you what the tests showed. Inferior vestibular nerve hypoplasia, posterior semicircular canal, catch-up saccades, normal VOR gain, catch-up saccades, SHIMF was abnormal, and there was a CVEMP abnormality. So you see, sometimes it just beautifully fits together like a jigsaw puzzle. So different kinds of dysmorphic. Here you see a common vestibular nerve. Facial, cochlear, superior inferior vestibular nerve is blurred, which means that this would be classed as a vestibular nerve dysplasia. Dilated endolymphatic duct is another term for an enlarged vestibular aqueduct. This is soft tissue. All of us have to follow this up with a CT scan. Right, this is the lipoma from a clavicle shift, not an acoustic, the patient I showed you. And this was a huge arteriovenous malformation. So I'm not going to dwell this because we don't try this in kids. So, but remember that nowadays Meniere's or endolymphatic hydrops can be visualized with special MR scan techniques, 3D flare, initial T2 weight, and then an intense dose of intravenous gadolinium and wait for 4 hours and then repeat scan. The problem with kids is after such a intravenous contrast material, you're asking the kid to wait for 4 years, which, you know, they didn't agree. And, you know, for I won't agree that as well. So this is the high drops technology. Once again, I've just given it here. I don't want to discuss this because this is something quite intense. So this is a normal MR scan. And this is a 3D flare high drops technique. You can see the saccule, the utricle, they're all full of black translucent images, which means they're full of fluid. So that's a renal lymphatic high drops. And Anya Barnett has got a classification. So Barnett's grade 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So brief word about advances in management. Vestibular management is now extremely holistic. As I said, it's not just you. A cognitive approach is essential. What do I mean by that? This has once again changed the face of vestibular medicine. Vestibular management. It's not my job just to pick up the vestibular weakness, find an etiology and treat the cause. No, it's empowering the patient, the child and the parents as to what is going on. It's called the cognitive closure. If something happens to you, don't you think you would want to know what's going on? And when you know what's going on, don't you think it's easier for you to accept it? And this has to be practiced not only with the child, but very importantly, you are dealing with the parents as well. And I have seen a range of reactions when they do not have a diagnosis. They come to me, I tell them for what's going on. For example, today, this kid went to 3 or 4 different specialties, 7 years, no diagnosis, dizziness. I told them what's going on and she started crying. This cognitive approach is absolutely crucial. Pharmacological management only as a short-term measure, because remember, long-term use of pharmacology misses a vestibular compensation, but it's a very important mainstay treatment for mania syndrome as well as vestibular migraine. Vestibular rehabilitation is now customized based on what you have got, the tests, but it should never be a blanket approach. In other words, right, so 14-year-old says I'm dizzy. Okay, you do some very basic tests, and I'll tell you what the tests are: cranial nerves, Romberg-Unterberger, nystagmus. Send for vestibular lab if there is any. They don't find anything. Vestibular rehab, completely wrong approach. Vestibular rehab will only work for decompensating vestibular weakness, right? Without any active vestibular condition. If that kid also has a vestibular migraine or a Meniere's, then vestibular rehabilitation might not work. You need intermittent decompensating episodes on a vestibular weakness, and your job doesn't stop there, because you'll have to figure out why the child is decompensating. So you'll have to do the blood test, you'll have to do vitamin acids, you'll have to look for iron. Iron deficiency anemia is a common cause for vestibular decompensation. Balance belt can be tried for bilateral vestibular hyperfunction in adults. It's Herman Kingma. It's a fantastic device. I've tried that in adults, very good results. Haven't tried that in kids as yet, but I'm going to try it on a kid with bilateral vestibular hyperfunction with head injury. So let's see what happens. Vestibular implant is of course gathering momentum. Our friend Raymond Vandenberg from Maastricht, Jay Rubinstein from Seattle, and you know, from Grand Cune area, Agnel, they are all doing all this wonderful job. Virtual reality is a routine in pediatric vestibular rehabilitation, with fantastic virtual reality rehabilitation delivered through a virtual reality goggles. Lifestyle changes are important, for example, for migraine, for many. More importantly, look, if a child comes to you with previous vestibular history, now completely asymptomatic, no symptom whatsoever, but on your vestibular function test, you find there is a weakness, you need to tell the child what to avoid so that he doesn't decompensate. And that's very crucial, very, very crucial. So you'll have to go through a full counseling as to what are the different factors which can lead to decompensation. And music therapy, we have done it in 1 or 2, and it has shown promise. There is evidence that music might actually nourish the central PIVC region, the peninsular vestibular cortex in the parietal lobe and the temporal lobe. It nourishes, and there is some evidence it might lead to a betterment. For example, when we rehabilitate our isolated otolith disorders, it's done with vestibular rehabilitation and with auditory feedback. So yeah, it does something, but yeah, evidence is emerging, but this is once again very, very new. The multidisciplinary team involved, you often might have to add, not often, but sometimes you'll have to involve cognitive behavioral therapy, You know, in the last 2 weeks, I have actually sent two kids because their intense emotional reaction to their vestibular problem. And you need occupational support and all these things, which is very, very important. Education is absolutely crucial in kids. So you have seen, you understand why I have included all this in my talk today, not just diagnostics, because this is changing the face of pediatric vestibular rehabilitation. This video is from Frank Kasabo, who's my colleague from Montpellier, who has revolutionized virtualis for virtual reality. So these are the different tests, these are the different routines that you take a child through, and I can tell you they just love it. And with good outcome, we haven't published anything. Plan to do after we do a few more. Visual vertigo. A child with visual vertigo goes through this shock that he likes. Very, very good way of rehabilitation and fun. Balance belt, we have mentioned that. Vestibular implant, we have mentioned that. And this is the algorithm which we have created in Alder Hey. So you have to do cognitive approach, vestibular rehabilitation, pharmacological rehabilitation, pharmacological management, cognitive device management when indicated, MDT, holistic, etc. Just the last one. This is just a summary of the different objective compensation measurements that you can do with the VNG. All these things change as the child compensates. So Alexander's nystagmus, head shake, mastoid vibration, Ennewort and HVIN may change, head heave changes, ocular contour rolling changes, video head impulse, the VOR gain improves, the saccades might become dispersed, and then they tend to cluster and become overts, which you can now measure by a very good score in adults called the PR score. Ray Martinez and Perez Fernandez, both our colleagues. This is now gaining momentum in adults. However, this has not been published or studied in kids. We intend to do that at some point. Suppression head impulse test, as I said, improvement in VOR gain. By far, I think this is the best way to assess compensation. Others are improvement in chair VOR gain, improving balance scale scores, and of course, a subjective sensation of well-being. That, of course, is very, very important. You know, how the child feels functionally. And remember, these tests might not reflect the functional improvement. So if the functional improvement is great, but the tests are still negative, you will still counsel the child, remember. So that's important to understand that they might be disproportionate to each other. So this is one of our patients, acute vestibular neuritis, I think in a 12 or 13 year old. This is the initial we hit, beautiful saccades, quite dispersed. And then you see the saccades are getting clustered with compensation. And finally, you see hardly any saccades, mainly coverts. This is a very nice one. This was an acute bilateral autoimmune labyrinthitis, bilateral hearing loss. So August 2022, only coverts, but normal VOR gain. This was about 3 months after the acute attack. August 2022, on the SHIMP, the peak saccadic velocity on the right was 269, which was abnormal by your laboratory standards, huge asymmetry. VOR was also quite low, but then it recovered in January 2023. See that with compensation. So, last slide, vestibular knowledge, golden age. It can be quantified, but we need more quantification. What do we need? We need frequency-specific information of the vertical neurons. We need more information about the otoliths. I mean, maybe not in my lifetime, but definitely in some of your lifetime. Imaging is improving day by day. Biomarkers are getting, even vestibular migraine, biomarker hunt is on. If you ask me, my biomarker for vestibular migraine is a high VOR gain. I have found this and I've published this. Vestibular implant, what else can I say? That is, who will use a very primitive weapon, which is a bone, with which he will rule the world. He will kill all other animals because he was a hunter at that time. and the weapon becomes a spaceship. That's exactly how we are moving. Thank you very much.